You know, in our last session, had a lot of things to cover, and for the most part, I was able to express them through an allergy haze, and I went back and I could not help but chuckle several times editing it, that because of that haze that I got a lot of names wrong. Sir Francis Bacon became Kevin Bacon, and we discovered that he was footloose in the Old Testament, or during ancient times, but I also realized that as I was looking over my notes that at the very end I forgot to turn the last page. And so I want to go back and touch this for a minute on the final chapter, if you will, of Cain. We discovered that Cain, his gifting in God was that of a farmer, yet he chose to reject the knowledge of God and the way that God wanted to do things by offering up the first fruits of his labor rather than that which God demanded. And God warned him and said, now listen, your wrath, there's this sin knocking at the door. And if you give in to it, it will have mastery over you. And it did. But what we also need to realize about our giftings is sin will destroy your giftings in God. It will either seize that gifting and use it for the other kingdom, or it will dismantle that gifting to where you cannot use it at all. And so you go through your whole life feeling like you don't fit in, part because part of our place in the earth, our purpose in the earth, is that gifting. Now what's interesting, I want to pick up here in Genesis chapter 4 verses 16 and 17. Part of Cain's curse from God, or judgment from God, was you're no longer going to be a farmer, you're going to be a vagabond. And so you're just going to roam the earth because of what you did. I want to show you some interesting things here. It's starting in verse 16. And Cain went out from the presence of God and dwelled in the land of Nod on the east of Eden. And Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Enoch. And he built a city and called the name of the city after the name of his son Enoch. And this is not the Enoch that we talk about that we was caught up into the you know, different things with the Book of Enoch. This was the first Enoch. And I didn't really realize that there were two Enochs in the Bible, or hadn't put it together until I was doing this study, that there was this Enoch that all he got named after him was a city. But we have this other Enoch from the line of Seth, whose father, I believe, was Jared, that walked with God. God took him because he was not. He just walked so close to God that the earth couldn't hold him anymore. But I want you to notice something interesting, that the development of the first city on planet Earth was developed by a man who resisted even the judgment of God and tried to overcome being a vagabond by establishing a city. His gifting was a farmer, but because he could no longer farm because of the sin within him, he ended up building cities. I thought that was very interesting. And I wonder sometimes when people just let sin absolutely control and take over their lives, how many of them have went to their plan B, which came from the kingdom of darkness, to try to circumvent the very judgment of God on their lives because of what they've done. Cain is a very good example. And I don't know about you, but I'd rather choose plan A. I would rather have dominion over sin and allow my gifting to be anointed by the Holy Spirit in this earth to fulfill my purpose in this earth. We're here for more than breathing, eating, and being consumers. Now that's all the elite want to reduce us to, is to keep their stuff going by being consumers. But God has so much more for us to be, and we only discovered in his kingdom. Now, with that said, we need to jump over to Genesis chapter 6. I want to start with Genesis chapter 6, verse 1. And I really had a lot of problems putting this together this morning. And it wasn't because of allergies. What really caused the problem is sorting through all the information that I had and what I wanted to cover and what necessarily doesn't need to be covered as far as this series is concerned, and what I'll be including in my next book, The Shearith Imperative. Because I can take some things just of what we find out here, and I could probably teach 15, 20 lessons. There's really that much there when you understand what's going on, and the establishment of Mystery Babylon and paganism and how it all is drawn from. The essence here is in these very chapters. And I'm going to be spending a lot of time dealing with them in my book, because when you understand that and the origin of what we believe in most of Western society, Eastern society, actually all of civilization, and how it's counter to the Word of God, makes our understanding of the commandments of God that much more paramount in the days that we live in. I'll say that before we go on. Let's pick up here in verse 1 of Genesis 6. And it came to pass when man began to multiply on the face of the earth, that the daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and they took them wives of all that they which they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for he is also flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came unto the daughters of men, and they bare children unto them, and the same became mighty men, which were of old men of renown. And God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Not only was it only evil, but it was only evil continually. And I think one of the things we're going to get into this morning, you need to underline that in your Bible. When you begin having the watchers interact directly with mankind, that is part of the symptomology for us to be able to look at to see if they're really involved in the things of man. It's always evil. Now I want to deal first of all with the principle of first mention. In the Word of God, as far as how it's written in chronological order. In Genesis, this is the first mentioning of B'nai Elohim. But one of the things that we have to question is when you begin looking at first mention, as far as the oldness of the book, there's another book that actually predates, according to most references, the book of Genesis, when Moses took the information face-to-face from God. That there's another book called the Book of Job. Now, scholars are divided on this. Many of the older scholars that do not give into textual criticism, and there's Chris Pinto and others has a whole thing about textual criticism is actually to take us away from the Word of God, not to get us deeper into the Word of God. And it was interjected by Catholics, if you will, into the Protestant movement because their biggest problem was, we believe this book, and we believe this book, you come out of that stuff. Okay? So very possibly, Job is much older than at least the writing part. In fact, many believe that Job actually lived around the time of Abraham. So you have Abraham over here and you have Job over here going through several different things. And so in the book of Job, in Job 1 and 6, it said, Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. Satan came also among them. And so one of the things that I postulate is that as far as the principle of first mention, we have to go back to Job for the definition of what the B'nai Elohim were. And it was very possibly well known to Moses and to all those in which he gave the Torah that they had already known the book of Job, since it was the oldest book. So in their hearing, when they hear that in those days the B'nai Elohim came and dwelt with the daughters of men and bore children, they would immediately go back to the book of Job and think, these were angels. In fact, really the Sethite theory doesn't hold up because good guys marry bad women all the time. Because the concept is that the sons of Seth were righteous men and they married the daughters of Cain. And so, good guys, bad women, and a lot of times we've seen good women marry bad guys. But yet what we have never seen is it produce giants. But when angels come down, that intermingling of DNA, and one of the things that I have kind of wondered, because I'm starting to see it in transhumanism, that if the DNA structure of angels are not different, that they may, instead of being a double helix, it may be a triple helix. Because even in transhumanism, they're in search of being able to create a triple helix within what they're postulating for the future. Just something to throw out there for us to consider. There's so much more than really what we know. And what's sad is because we have bought into things like the Sethite theory and so many other things that we are handicapped. All of esotericism points back to Genesis 6, and all of them uniformly, I've not been able to find an exception yet, all point to Genesis 6 and talk about it and say that those were angels. As well as all of them brag about to include modern esoteric men, to including those from coming from the UN, are still saying to this day that we are still looking to obtain the knowledge of good and evil promised to us so that we might become gods. It's called the Luciferian initiation. So in some instances, they believe these concepts out of the Word of God more than we do. Another problem that I have with the Sethite theory is that it was basically presented and postulated by a guy named Julius Africanus, who was a Catholic apologist in the 5th century. And when you look at most of the anti-Nicene fathers prior to that time, they almost uniformly, from Tertullian to Clement of Rome, all go back, or Clement of Alexandria, I'm sorry, go back and interpret this as angels. But only after Julius Africanus do we have people like Augustine who championed this and embraced it. And he was actually the one who embedded it really into Catholic theology, and we borrowed from that. So I, one of the things that I firmly believe is the Bible can say exactly what it means. These were B'nai Elohim, these were angels. They were not just righteous men, because there was more afoot, if you will, than just good guys marrying bad women. But the other thing that we need to deal with is the canonization of Scripture in the Book of Enoch. Because in many of these debates and discussion, I remember discussing with several other men, and they tied more into the Sethite theory. And so one of the things is, well, I wonder really what was behind the rabbi's idea of not having Enoch as a part of the canon of Old Testament, or the Tanakh, the Old Testament Scripture. And so I began digging into that because inquiring minds want to know. And what I found out, that I had always assumed, and somehow or another it didn't stick when I was going through seminary when you study the canonization of Scripture, that by the time of Jesus, the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, and the Navaim, the prophets, were pretty well established and the canon was set. But what was in flux was the Ketuvim, the writings. They had not yet been canonized. In fact, the final canonization, many speculate, can happen. I've heard some say between 40 to 70 AD, some even into the second century AD. So the writings in which the apocryphal writings would be considered, like the Book of Enoch and so forth, were still in flux in the times of Jesus and the times of the apostles. That's why Jesus alludes to it, Paul alludes to it, and even Jude quotes from it, because in their own minds, it was considered at that time a part of canon. Kind of makes you wonder, doesn't it? And one of my personal beliefs is I've studied this thing out and say, okay, why did the rabbis after Jesus reject the Book of Enoch and reject some of the other books? One of the reasons is because these books, because in the Book of Enoch you also have the coming of Messiah. And some of the other books, like the Book of Jasher and other, that some of these books was causing the messianic fervor that was really strong during the time of Jesus that caused them to demand a Messiah, and they looked and Jesus came, and now they rejected Jesus, so you have the fervor of Simon Bar Kochba, which ended up being a complete failure, which happened in the second century. And so what the rabbis did is they were codifying the Ketuvim. They pulled out any writings that in their minds caused the messianic fervor and pulled them out and didn't include them in canon. That's what may very possibly be one of the reasons why the Book of Enoch is not a part of canon. But I may want to add that in the original 1611 King James Bible, because there are so many King Jamesers out there, the original King James 1611 Bible included the Apocrypha, which had the Book of Enoch in it. Just putting that out there. But later on, it was rejected because it was one of those apocryphal books, not the Book of Enoch, but another one that Catholic theology had developed the concept of purgatory. And therefore, they threw out the baby with the bathwater. But after 1948, we have the establishing of Israel. We also have the crazy thing that Jack Parsons and all those did in the backside of the desert here in the U.S., that when they discovered the Dead Sea Scrolls, right along with Isaiah, was the Book of Enoch. And so maybe God is saying there's some things that you need to understand. This is not essential for salvation, but let me tell you something. It may very well be essential for us getting a clue with what's going on in this day and this hour, especially as the within academic circles and First Nations government money are being poured into the transhumanist movement to give birth back to the Raphaim and the Nephilim once again. So with all that said, you can agree with me or you can disagree with me. That's okay. But I want to read some things that out of the Book of Enoch that that actually coincide with Genesis chapter 6. This one isn't found in Enoch 6. Isn't it interesting, Genesis 6, Enoch 6? Just saying. And it came to pass when the children of men had multiplied that in those days there were born unto them beautiful and comely daughters. And the angels, the children of heaven, saw and lusted after them and said one to another, come, let us choose us wives from among the children of men and begot us children. And Samjazar, who was their leader, said unto them, I fear ye will not indeed agree to do this deed, and I alone will have to pay the penalty of a great sin. And they all answered him and said, Let us all swear an oath and all bind ourselves by mutual imprecations, not to abandon this plan, but to do this thing. Then they swore all together and bound themselves with mutual imprecations upon it, and they were all in 200. So you had 200 of these angels, watch your class angels. Do this, who descended in the days of Jared on the mount of Mount Hermon, and they called it Mount Hermon because they swore and bound themselves by mutual imprecations upon it. And so the very reason that we call Mount Hermon Mount Hermon is because its name originated in a legend that these 200 angels came and descended upon that mountain, and there they made their covenant and swore an oath with one another that we're going to do this thing. Well, what's so powerful about Mount Hermon? To this day, Mount Hermon is ground zero. That Jesus, when he stood and said, upon this rock I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it, he was sitting there and with his apostles and he was staring at Mount Hermon. He's the same guy that said, as in the days of Noah, chooses to teach this concept of binding and loosing and that the gates of hell would not prevail against it. And he was looking at Mount Hermon when he identified it as the gates of hell, which he agreed with the Greeks and the Romans. In fact, there was a grotto there established for Pan right there, and there was a cave that had been born out in that mountain that the Greeks had taught that is the entrance to Hades. On that mountain, you will also find, when you begin looking at that mountain and studying the history of it, that Nimrod had a fortress on Mount Hermon. Go and Google the typology of Mount Hermon, and you will see things like the goat of Mendes, many believe that that is where Azazel is trapped in the desert at Mount Hermon. And if you look at the typology, there's actually a goat head in Mount Hermon. Why is that important? Because you go back and you look at Jerusalem, and God said, I'm going to go in a place where I'm going to put my name. There is actually a sheen like a mezuzah in the three mountains of Mount Hermon. Or not Mount Hermon, but Mount Zion in the mountains of Jerusalem. God also said, I want to live in your heart. And if you get an echocardiogram of a heart, there is a sheen, just like on a mezuzah, in your heart. God said, I put my name on your heart. And so and sometimes some of this stuff is fascinating. Josh Peck just recently released a video that all you got to do is pull it up on Google Maps and you just outline the topography. And at Roswell, in the topography, there's a big red hair alien in the topography at Roswell. I looked at that and said, say what? It's there. I saw it with my own eyes. But what's really interesting is the crash at Roswell, and this was done by David Flynn, that you go back and you take the crash coordinates of Roswell, and you apply them to pi, and you get the coordinates of Mount Hermon. And before they moved, it used to be that Zulu time or the Zulu meridian used to be on Paris, and they moved it for political correctness for whatever reason. But if you go back to the one that they used in ancient times, Mount Hermon is 33 degrees by 33 degrees. Maybe just where Masons get the 33rd degree from. Mount Hermon is ground zero. Just kind of throwing out some of these things. There are too many clues for it. It's too much to be a coincidence. In fact, I think when the great delusion comes and these creatures come back, they're going to manifest on Mount Hermon. But you want to know another piece of the story that's pretty awesome? When Jesus was transfigured, and Peter says, "Man, we need to build some sukkahs here, one for Elijah, one for Moses, one for you." Jesus did that on the top of Mount Hermon. He says, you think you're glorious? Let me show you in my splendor. And he not only said that that mountain and what they did was not going to overcome the church, God's called out ones, but he went and transfigured himself on the top of the mountain that they touched down on. He says, "You may be a watcher, but I am the glorious one." And showed himself in all his splendor. I mean, this stuff is awesome when you start digging into it. And it's just like, it's unbelievable the detail that is in it when you begin to study it out. Now, like I said, almost all the early church fathers, the anti-Nicene fathers, all the rabbinical sources, even Josephus himself said that this was angels came down and mated with women and produced giants. Now, how many know that they did not give birth to giants? As far as those were not giant babies. That no mama would have said, like, they had wives, they had birth, they were looking for other wives. That isn't in Scripture. But what we have discovered in genetics, in fact, there's something called a liger, that when they blend a tiger and a lion together, that it causes the growth gene, the growth hormone, not to turn off, and so they just keep on growing. And look them up on the internet, you end up with a several thousand pound liger. Humongous things. And what's interesting is the guys that are breeding them are naming them after Greek gods. Maybe they know something that we're still just now catching up to. Now, the twofold purpose of the watchers. This is something interesting. The Bible is silent about when the watchers fell. Even the book of Enoch doesn't say, "And these were the angels that fell with Lucifer." One of the things that I have postulated in this series is there may be subsequent falling of various angels. That's why the Apostle Paul says to tell women to have a spiritual covering on your head, really talking about male headship, not a hanky, but male headship, for the sake of the angels. Because he's referring back to Genesis chapter 6 and what happened. We do know that by the time we get into the book of Revelation, that their total is one-third of the angels. Hence another reason why the highest degree Mason, 33, is they're aligning themselves with the one-third that fell with Lucifer, as well as the 33 degrees, or 33 by 33 that Mount Hermon was on. It all fits together. So very possibly when they descended upon Mount Hermon and decided to do this thing is the fall of these 200 watchers. Now this is simply speculation, but what is very evident, when you read the book of Enoch, when you read what the effects of them upon mankind, you realize that they were continuing the promise and the mission of the Nechesh in Genesis chapter 3. It was more than just producing giants. There's so much more involved. Now, the first thing that we need to understand is they contaminated the DNA pool on Earth. Now, we read this. Let's see, which two would I want to begin first here? Okay, the Bible says that Noah was perfect in his generations. That perfect means he had pure human DNA. pure human DNA was needed for the coming of Messiah. So by Genesis chapter 6, this one that was promised by God to crush the head of the Nechesh had not come yet. And so part of the way of preventing, very possibly, the coming of Messiah was to so contaminate the DNA pool that there were no longer any pure humans for Messiah to have a line from. And then when you really read the text and you read what's going on, that they're evil, that their heart is evil continually, except for Noah and his family, that if this would have continued maybe another two generations, there would not have been a line left. God was very strategic. He waited till the very last minute and said, I've got to do something, or this is going to corrupt everything in my creation, and I'll no longer be able to produce the Messiah. So God had to act. So that's part of the reason. The second part of the reason is there was a whole lot of knowledge that was promised by the Nechesh that man hadn't had yet. All we see up until Genesis 6 is this evil. This nature of iniquity began to take hold of men. And so here man was longing for this knowledge promised by the Nechesh, and the watchers came to deliver it. I'm going to go to Enoch chapter 7, verses 1 through 6. And I want to read you a couple of things. And it says, and all the others together with them took unto them wives, each chose for himself one, and they began to go into them and to defile themselves with them. And they taught them charms and enchantments and the cutting of roots, and made them acquainted with plants. And they became pregnant, and they bare great giants whose height was 3,000 ells. Now this is the first round. This is the true Nephilim. Everything after the first ones are really called Gibberim, Raphaim, and many other. There was only one original what we call Nephilim in the Word of God. And they were 480 feet tall. That's how tall 3 ells is. That's tall. And how many know it takes a lot of food to feed somebody? Could you imagine what their resting basal rate is? You know, it's like if they don't get up, they're going to burn 10,000 calories a day. Or more. So it says, and look what it says here. It says, who consumed all the acquisitions of men, and when man could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against them and devoured mankind. And they went beyond that. They also began to sin against birds and beasts and reptiles and fish, and devoured one another's flesh and drank blood. And then the earth laid accusation against the lawless ones. Lawless ones, ones who stand against the covenant with God, antinomia. And so what we read in this is not only the concept of cannibalism, drinking blood, or even blending a species. We see that they first taught them charms and enchantments. What's that? They taught them witchcraft and sorcery. They taught these women this, so we can go back and say, where did the understanding to channel powers other than God, that is the very foundation, the Gaia spirit, or whatever the spirit you want to call it. And I really personally, I believe the Gaia spirit, which our Pope is even telling, the Pope's talking about, he's not my Pope, the Pope is talking about, and many others, is actually the nature of iniquity in the earth that they tend to call mother. No, ain't my mama. I'm born again. I'm born from above, out of incorruptible seed from the Word of God. I've been freed. But also says cutting of roots. Now, I thought that was, you know, herbology maybe, but not really. Cutting of roots is there when you begin studying divination, the origin of divination was a root cutter. They taught them to cut roots to make predictions, divination. The acquisition of plants. Basically what they taught them with being acquainted with plants was pharmakia. That's also they taught them how to grow pot, you know. Because what we see in many of shamanism is the use of plant extracts to bring one into an altered state of consciousness and open up one's mind to the spirit realm. The watchers taught them how to do that. That there were principalities and powers in the second heaven that fell, and by smoking this dope or making this tea, that you can open up your mind to their influence and they will begin teaching you. That originated with the watchers and with their children. But here are some other things in the Shiner Directive. I trace back some of these following passages, these following practices to the children of the watchers. Bestiality, they begin to sin and defile the animals. Homosexuality, pedophilia, incest, cannibalism, and the drinking of blood all go back to the watchers and to their children. That's where all these concepts were introduced. And what's interesting is all these concepts are condemned in the Torah. Through the practices of the other side. Now, when you really understand this, and what's interesting is that also we could also add transhumanism and the blending of species together, because not only here, but in the book of Jasher and later on in Enoch, you find out that they learned how to blend species. They taught man how to blend species. That part of the reason that God had to have the flood of Noah was because the original transhumans corrupted all flesh and all animals. It's very possibly that the few animals that came to be on Noah's ark were the ones that were left pure, just like he was. So some of the commandments of God, and this was actually in an interview I did with Josh Peck, there was one person wrote up and said, you know, now with the eating thing, is that kind of, how does that go along with the, you know, you shouldn't blend cotton and wool together in the garments, or you shouldn't blend seed together. And really there's a lot of things in the commandments of God. When God first gave his commandments, it took them 3 years, 3.5 years just to hear the original Torah cycle, because the only ones that back then that even had access to the Torah were the Levites. And so when they would gather on feast days 3 times a year, part of the duties of the Levites were to read it, so you couldn't pick up the Torah and take it home and read it with you. So there are some things that God did within their culture that served as a mnemonic, a physical mnemonic, that when they would see that, they would remember something. It's like the tzitzit on the prayer shawl. God says, when you look at the knots and you look at the blue cord and everything else, you'll remember my commandments. Because what's interesting is you take the number of cords and you times it by the knots, and it's 613, the exact number of commandments in the Torah, as well as the understanding that blue cord, you can't do any of it without Messiah. And you can even go further with the tallit, that there are stripes upon it, by his stripes we are healed, and that the fringe and that tzitzit is also called the wings. And so the woman with the issue of blood that reached out and touched the hem of his garment, she grabbed a tzitzit because she knew what God had said through Malachi. But also when you put it on, it represents, because everything about the tallit represents Christ. And so I can see the Apostle Paul using that as a prop, if you will, to teach Gentiles, when you start walking with Jesus, you got to put off your garments of unrighteousness and you got to put on Christ. It's also a type and shadow of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. When Elijah ascended, his mantle or his tallit descended. And when Elisha put it on, he was able to do greater works than Elijah. It's all there. It's all powerful. So many times this blending of the seed is God is saying, don't allow yourself to be blended with other things anymore, because it brings absolute corruption. Now, the forbidden knowledge continues in Enoch 8:1-8. And Azazel taught men to make swords and knives and shields and breastplates, and made them and made known to them the metals of the earth, and the art of working them, and bracelets and ornaments, and the use of antimony. And I thought, well, what in the world is antimony? I looked it up. Well, first of all, it has the chemical chemical element of the atomic number 51, but it is a brittle, silvery white a metalloid, and in ancient times they used it for mascara. But they would also use it, that was a chemical that they would use in making alloys. So even the concept of blending metals together, and so antimony was used as a base to help promote the making of alloys that they would use pewter, or they would use lead with. So I thought that was really interesting. But antimony can also go back with mascara, because the next verse is the beautifying of eyelids and all kinds of costly stones and all coloring tenures. And there arose such ungodliness, and they committed fornication, and they were led astray and brought corrupt in all their ways. And Samjaza taught enchantments and root cuttings. I'm not going to try to pronounce the rest of these because there's not a Smith among them or a Jones. But the next one, the revolving of enchantments and astrology. And the next one, the constellations and the knowledge of clouds and the signs of the earth and the signs of the sun and the course of the moon. And as men perished, they cried, and their cry went up to heaven. Now, what's interesting in all of this, we see that they're teaching them ungodly things. Now, what's fascinating is when you start studying things like the course of the planets and astronomy, on those aspects, ancient men knew more than the men of the Middle Ages. Before the developing of the telescopes, they knew more. We are discovering that with the Aztecs and the Mayans and all those, they had a greater understanding of our solar system than anyone did of that era. And it was impossible for them to know if someone that didn't have an understanding of them did that. But one of the things that's dropped out that really jumped out to me is they taught them astrology. That, you know, are you a Taurus? Are you a Sagittarian? That originated with the Watchers, and what it did, Bollinger has a wonderful book called Witness in the Stars, that when you look at the original meaning of the star, of the constellations, it's literally the Gospels in the heaven printed out. And so one of the things the Watchers did was they changed all the definition to pervert them, to make it go with their magic and their rituals that they were doing. So they literally came down to pervert the gospel. And what's interesting in every things that we have from the aliens, from the UFOs, is, you know, none of them ever come down and have a problem with Buddha. They never have a problem with Muhammad. They all have a problem with Jesus and with the gospel. Now, why would somebody travel 100 million light years and pick on this one religion when there are so many on planet Earth? Why choose the gospel? Because that's what they did the first time they came. They tried to expunge his witness in the stars and pervert the gospel into something else. I find that fascinating. That's why God can really tell you, really says when he means it, I will tell you the end from the beginning. It just repeats itself all over again. Now we pick up here in Enoch 12. Enoch, thou scribe of righteousness, go and declare to the watchers of the heavens who have left the high heaven and the holy eternal place and have defiled themselves with women and had done as the children of earth do and have taken unto themselves wives. Ye have wrought great destruction on the earth. Ye shall have no peace nor forgiveness of sins, inasmuch as they delight themselves in their children. Now what's interesting, and I've shared this before, man was created in the image of God, therefore he could repent. What you see with the watchers, they were fearful of the judgment, but they couldn't repent. They were just fearful of the consequences. God fixed the consequences. Enoch, go up and see if you can fix this because we don't want our children to die. But there was no repentance. Not once you say, man, I'm really sorry I did this. It's just God just stay the judgment. And so when you have people that manifest that same nature, they're manifesting the nature of the watchers that is a part of the mystery of iniquity. Just want to throw that out. They're unrepentant. But he says, ye shall have no peace nor forgiveness of sin, as much as ye delighted themselves and their children. The murder of their beloved ones shall they see, and over the destruction of their children shall they lament, and shall make supplication unto eternity. But mercy and peace shall ye not obtain. And Enoch went to Azazel. Thou shalt have no peace if a severe sentence has gone on forth against thee to put thee in bonds, and thou shalt have no toleration or request granted to thee because of the unrighteousness of what thou hast taught, and because of the works of the of godlessness and unrighteousness and sin which thou hast shown to men. Now the watchers delighted in their children. I think part of the temptation for them, and I recently heard one preacher try to use out of Ezekiel that this woman had wings like a stork, and it's a prophetic image. It's the Bible's very clear when God says, and they saw angels, and here's what they look like. That is not contained in that scripture. It is prophetic imagery. There are no such thing as female angels. It is nowhere recorded in scripture. Now, some have speculated that angels are hermaphrodite, and that's the speculation that God never divided the two sexes because he never meant for them to procreate like he did with man, or simply he made them all male. But the concept of the ability to procreate was a great temptation to them. That's why the Apostle Paul says a woman should have a godly spiritual covering in her life for the sake of the angels. But part of their judgment, God says, I'm going to bind you in the earth for 70 generations, and you're going to watch the destruction of your children. And the original titans, if you will, because that's what the Greeks called them, the 480-footers, they end up going to war with each other and basically killed themselves out. And the Greeks look at this and said, well, there was the titans that warred against the new god class, which was like Zeus and all that, what we would call Gibberim. And the Gibberim won. But they were forced to watch their own children kill each other, and they remained bound up for 70 generations. When you look at this, it's about 350 BC, or 3500 BC, that all this occurred. And so if you go 70 generations, it's at the ending of the 19th century and the turning of the 20th century is about the time that they're being released. And I believe their release is progressive. And the very last of them, as we find in the book of Revelation, there are four angels bound under the Tigris and Euphrates River. No good angels, is there a record of them ever being bound? Why would they need to be bound? But when these get loosed, all hell breaks loose with them. There's also another interesting concept that Azazel, because it's particularly mentioned here, Azazel was the worst of all the watchers. That he taught men many, many forbidden things. And he was targeted out more than Samjaza, who was the leader, because he taught so many more forbidden things that he was so renowned, he was bound up in the desert place, that when they got to the Day of Atonement, they had two goats. One was for Yahweh, and one was for Azazel. In fact, Azazel eventually became that his name, if you would look up and you would pull up in Strong's Concordance, scapegoat in the Hebrew, it's Azazel in the Hebrew. And so let all sin be ascribed to Azazel is what the priest would say as he laid his hands on that scapegoat and sent it out into the wilderness, because Azazel was bound up in the wilderness, most likely at the foot of Mount Hermon. Now later on, they were afraid that, you know, what happens if this goat kind of wanders in the wilderness and comes back into town? Is it bringing all the sins back with it? So they eventually changed what God said to do. They just push it off a cliff and they wouldn't have to worry about it. But you need to realize that there's so much more in the Word of God that's embedded in this that we don't understand. It's there if we would just dig it out and be good stewards. Now the effects of the watchers and their children. In Genesis 6, 4 through 5, it says, and the giants were in the earth in those days, and after that, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, and the same became mighty men, men of renown. Now, you need to underline that in your Bible. Men of renown. That became the definition. And that word is Gibberim. And this is the first mention of the word Gibberim in the Bible. But both in the Bible and in ancient cultures, when somebody became a mighty man, they would refer back to the exploits of these Nephilim, that their prowess, their intelligence, their viciousness, their ability to win in battle, all these things go back to the Gibberim, that they became Gibberim. And also that many of them became worshipped as gods. And so we get the concept, Nebuchadnezzar thought he was becoming a god because he was excelling in knowledge and strength. That all the Caesars became as gods. This is where we get the concept of ascension and apotheosis. That if you could achieve becoming a Gibberim to the place of using arcane knowledge, that you could enter into godhood promised by the serpent in Genesis chapter 3. It's all interconnected. Now, as far as I can tell, Nephilim is only used of the original batch, but after that, They could be called Gibberim. They could be called Raphaim. Moses names many, I guess, were the tribes, the Amalekites, the Zamzamims, and many others. But Gibberim and Raphaim tend to be the Hebrew words that's used a lot for these. You say, well, why are you bringing all that up today? Because a fellow Mason in America that's serving and doing all his stuff in statehood and everything and does it well, they will lay him out in interment in the state capitol in the rotunda, which is Isis' womb, which is where he is supposed to have apotheosis in the next world to become a god, according to Mason lore. All of that stems from this. This is what I'm dealing with is ground zero for all esotericism in the Word of God, or in the world. All esotericism that is mystery Babylon, the mystery of iniquity, all begins here, and it just unfolds and is reintroduced back in history. Now, in my book, The Shinar Directive, I share how I believe that the elite within esoteric society knew that they were never going to be able to do what they wanted until the Watchers returned. They knew that that was going to be sometime during the 19th and 20th century. And what I postulated in my book is that's one of the reasons they introduced evolution and eugenics, which sets the world up perfectly for the Genesis 6 experiment today. That's the basis for transhumanism today. But I've been begin developing a friendship with Doug Woodward, and through his books, I'm putting another piece of the puzzle together that during the 19th century, there was this huge revival of spiritualism. That's where Blavatsky came from, and many others. They came out of that era that began to sow this stuff. Yet this week I can say it. Helena Petrova Blavatsky. Okay, I can get it this week. All of that came out of that era, so much so that when G.H. Pembroke wrote his classic work on Earth's Earliest Ages, it's good to have notes, that he deals with all this stuff, all going all the way back to the Watchers, and what they did was because he was pointing to the spiritualism that was that literally it all came from Europe and it went up like 15 levels out around New York. And then it began to go back into the earth. He was saying, listen, guys, I know where this originates because so many ministers were blending this into the gospel. And back then, many ministers had no problems with doing seances and preaching the gospel on Sunday. I mean, some crazy, crazy stuff. And so Pembroke said, I know where all this originated. It originated with the Watchers, Genesis 6. And he wrote his magnum opus on this book, and it's a phenomenal book. Because he knew. And so you had as America was exporting the gospel, it was also exporting another gospel. Spiritualism, the very heart of esotericism into the earth. And so there has been both pure water and bitter waters flowing from the same nation. That's one of the reasons why God needs to judge a good part of America. Now let's go on. When we see the effects of let me add something else. I thought this was interesting. I was reading after a modern philosopher, and he said that we no longer teach mythology in schools anymore. But where is it taught? It's taught in the modern comic strip. That they drew from mythology as they were developing Captain America is a Raphaim. The Red Skull is a Raphaim. The X-Men are Raphaim. The Hulk is a gamma-charged Raphaim. In fact, in the second remake of Hulk, there's a scene where this doctor up in a university in New York City is trying to cure him, and so they have to induce an episode, and all of a sudden he becomes Hulk-sized. And later on, that doctor said, I got mesmerized with that because it was so God-like. That is a primal instinct of sinful man to not look at the God of heaven and earth and say he's God-like, but to look at these Nephilim, these Raphaim, these creatures that have skewed the DNA that God created for man and say, that's what it's like to become a God, that Bruce Banner became a God of rage. Maybe like Mars, except green instead of red. Although within their mythology, they also have a Red Hulk, just to throw that out there. All that stems from, if our kids won't teach mythology when we begin doing these things because they grow up on comics instead of the Word of God, that these things will be a natural progression for them when the day comes. Just wanted to throw that out there. I mean, it's all embedded right in there. The X-Men, the next evolution, the new Homo Superior that when he comes along will eventually wipe out the Homo sapiens. Nephilim with extra powers to become men of renown. Why am I saying all this? Because we need to understand, guys, as we approach the end of days, that the knowledge that the Watchers gave man are taking hold in unprecedented ways. And I'm going to touch on this. No, I'm not. We'll wait till next week on some of this other stuff. But it's going to give you an understanding of why Islam is raising so much in such favor today. In fact, recently there was a street preacher preaching the gospel that was attacked by a Muslim. And there is such favored status given to them right now in America that those cops didn't think that they could arrest a Muslim for attacking a Christian on the streets of New York. Physically attacking. Now, I'm sure if that preacher would have held his own and knocked that Muslim down and knocked him out, they would have most likely probably charged the Christian. But there are reasons for that, which we're going to get into next week. But we need to understand that the knowledge that the Watchers gave, and this goes from transhuman to Luciferianism, is expanding in unprecedented ways in the earth today. This is why, guys, that being able to identify what is of the kingdom of darkness and the things of the kingdom of darkness is so important, so that we can separate unclean, clean, and go back to the commandments of God. The Torah was given to a people that came out of 400 years of bondage from a civilization that was founded on Watcher technology and doctrines, the esoteric. And the only way that God could get their minds purged of the teaching of the Watchers and the teaching of the Nekesh is they had to meditate on the Torah. And even the Apostle James says, go back and receive with meekness the engrafted word, and only the Old Testament existed when he said that, for the saving of your souls. That's why understanding the kingdom of God and the commandments of God are essential this day, because so much has been blended. And if it's been blended, the kingdom of darkness will take it over. That's why we got to separate it out in the days that we're in. Now, Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you would give us an anointing, a fresh anointing from heaven. Father, a fresh anointing by the Holy Spirit. Father, that you would give us a supernatural ability to do exactly what the Torah says, to separate the clean from the unclean, the profane from the holy. And Father, to be able to separate the doctrines of demons, the doctrines of the Watchers, the doctrines of the Nekesh, from the doctrines of the kingdom of God, we ask. Father, let a fresh anointing fall on us from this day forth, that our eyes would be opened, that we would see and that we would understand, so that we could begin walking in your kingdom and your kingdom alone. In Jesus' name.